Something strange is happening. We are living through the most extraordinary moment in human history. After decades of denial and ridicule, government officials and the mainstream media are admitting that extraterrestrial civilizations are visiting Earth. But there's a twist. The same people and institutions who lied about ETs and just about everything else are now framing the extraterrestrial presence as a threat.
And we are seriously thinking of the Space Force.
One man has been trying to warn us about this for decades.
If you're seeing this, it's because I am either dead or have been entrapped or have disappeared.
Most of us are ill-prepared for open contact with an advanced ET civilization. As our expanding cosmology outgrows our theological institutions, modern human society is spiraling into decadence, narcissism, depravity, and nihilism.
Catch me outside, how about that?
If we want to truly understand ETs, their technology, and their intentions, we have to readdress our assumptions about the nature of reality and our relationship with the physical universe.
On the surface, oh, UFOs are real, there are these machines zipping through the sky. But one of the things I've always said is, well, that's interesting, and it's cool, and it's great to see them. But what's really interesting are the people on board those spacecraft. They're intelligent, they're conscious, they're here, they're interested. Why are they here otherwise? But no one has made the question, how do we develop that relationship with the occupants of the UFOs? That's what this is about. It's going from just sort of a materialistic view, there's a machine flying around the sky, and sort of a superficial view of it, to a deeper truth of who's on board, why are they here? What is their relationship to humanity, perhaps the origins of the human race? What are we to do to create a relationship with them, and how do we do that? What is the foundation of a relationship between humans at this stage of our evolution and civilizations that are hundreds of thousands to millions of years more developed technologically and socially and perhaps in consciousness? We have to find where that point of commonality is. I have put a briefing together for every president since Bill Clinton, and to the extent that they know anything, it doesn't mean they have control over these covert programs. The unacknowledged special access projects are run in a way that they are outside the purview and control of the president or the Congress. And for that reason, our elected representatives are unlikely to resolve this problem. But we can resolve it by going directly to these civilizations and saying, we're here. You can make contact with us. We're unarmed. We are friendly.
Since 1990, a network of free thinkers and renegades have been bypassing the national security state to make direct contact with advanced extraterrestrial civilizations. Using the Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind protocols, or CE5, developed by Dr. Greer, this has proven to be the most subversive and dangerous information he has released to the public.
Oh my gosh. Close Encounters of the First Kind consists of visual sightings of an unidentified flying object. Close Encounters of the Second Kind, some physical trace is present, like impressions in the ground or scorched vegetation. Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the occupants or pilots of an ET craft are witnessed. Close Encounters of the Fourth Kind, a human is brought on board an ET craft. Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind, proactive human-initiated communication with extraterrestrial beings. Most of the phenomena presented in this film were photographed or recorded during a CE5 contact event. For thousands of people, contact has begun. This is their story.
This got on the radar of the intelligence community, and they knew that we had come across the Rosetta Stone of contacting and communicating with interstellar civilizations, and it worked. That is what started the intelligence community coming after what we were saying and doing and trying to intercept it. This is, in fact, cosmic disobedience on a grand scale. We're going to bypass the sociopaths in these covert programs and do this directly. It's the same thing with the civil rights movement. The civil rights movement would have never happened from the top down. Even the Kennedy brothers did not want to step into that mess. It took a mass of people, not just Martin Luther King, but millions of people all over the country doing sit-ins and lunch counter sit-ins and buses and what have you to change that direction of our civilization out of Jim Crow onto a society that is, while not perfect, is more open and inclusive than it was. Well, the same has to happen here. And to do that, we have to understand what cosmic consciousness is and what the nature of the cosmic mind is that is resonating within every single human being. Because that's the foundation for the relationship between humans and these civilizations. By doing it directly, all of us are going to know what the truth is. You don't have to go through a proxy or someone who's telling you secondhand. But it also creates a movement globally to show these civilizations that there are people on this planet who are enlightened and conscious and peaceful, which is the majority of humans. Because real disclosure is humans making contact with these civilizations directly. And these civilizations are waiting for us to do it. And so this is our opportunity. This is our moment. And it really is we, the people, that have to do it.
Well, for decades, only crackpots and crazy people believed in UFOs. That's what I thought anyway. And then in recent years, it turns out that governments have been taking them seriously all along. Very seriously. We'll be right back.
question is often asked, when will UFO disclosure happen? The answer is, it has already happened. It happened in 2001 at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., where military, NASA, and intelligence agency whistleblowers testified to their involvement in the UFO cover-up and the back engineering of extraterrestrial technologies. It happened again in 2017 with the release of the film Unacknowledged, in anticipation of which the CIA and the FBI published millions of UFO documents on their websites. Despite all this, nothing has really changed. Life goes on as before, except there is a new narrative unfolding in the mainstream media, one that is designed to subvert true disclosure and extinguish the opportunity for transformation available to us through these revelations.
Earlier this week, the New York Times and Politico revealed the existence of a secret government program to investigate UFO sightings.
It was especially focused on encounters by members of the military, like this one experienced by a U.S. Navy pilot off the coast of California.
There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the ASA. My gosh. They're all going against the wind. The wind's 120 knots to the west. Look at this thing. It's rotating.
Average people see UFOs, you know, on the news, right? All of a sudden, it's real. UFOs, we've been tracking them in the sky. And they go, okay, well, were the tinfoil hat people right? It took a long time for the mainstream media finally admit that, yeah, you know, they are in fact real. Why did we wait that long? Why did we wait for the mainstream media to tell us before we finally believed, hey, this is actually happening? And the challenge is, if there's potentially multiple narratives, how do you decide which one to go with?
Back in the 1990s, I was read into or briefed on a project that involved an interagency group that had the ability to disclose the ET presence in a way that would frighten everyone on Earth and convince the public that there was an alien threat, which is completely false. It's all a lie. And that this had been developed in the 50s. And they had been developing the means and the psychological warfare to make that happen. So in the 1990s, I wrote a paper called When Disclosure Serves Secrecy. And what that means is there are two kinds of disclosures that might happen, a truthful one that is also a hopeful one, which is what I gave up my medical career to try to actuate and do. And then there's the one that is spun by the spinmeisters in Washington and at the Pentagon and CIA, which runs like this. It's true, the UFOs are real. They're here as a threat. They're violating our airspace. They're a national security and a threat, and a threat to our sovereignty. I'm quoting.
The purpose of the program, Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Program, was really designed to do just that. From a national security perspective, identify those things that we see and try to ascertain and determine if that information is a potential threat to national security.
And we knew this was going to happen because I had met with people who were in these classified projects who were on interagency committees that had everything set to roll this out, and they were just waiting for the right time. The Soviet Union has ended. We have the global terrorism, while it's still there, it's not like it was around 9/11. This is the next big thing that they want the public to be afraid of.
When a pickpocket meets a saint, all he sees are his pockets. Or like if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And it's not that this isn't a genuine perception on their part, because they've been raised, their entire political and professional career has been designed to have this kind of artificial construct of this, there's this national airspace and nobody can come into the airspace unless we say so. And they've got this super control mechanism going. And they're right at this really important place right now where they're attempting to establish a kind of one world government. You know, that they've gotten the communication systems up, the transportation systems up, and they want to establish a planetary government. And there's nothing that is going to motivate the creation of a one world government like the discovery of an ultimate other. Ronald Reagan, standing in front of the United Nations, he said it right out.
Perhaps we need some outside universal threat. I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
He was silly enough to say it. You know, that's part of his naivete. But the fact is, that is their agenda.
Legendary civil rights attorney Daniel Sheehan has spent over 50 years fighting the national security state. The Pentagon Papers and the Iran-Contra scandals are but two of his many landmark cases before becoming a whistleblower and legal counsel for the Disclosure Project in 2001.
It's helpful, of course, for them to say, oh, UFOs are real. That's quite helpful. We've been trying to get people to understand that now for the last 30 years. But it's all immediately wedded to this fact that they're this horrible threat. And so we have to come forward with a positive set of programs, a positive vision for this. And that's what I'm trying to help get the Vatican and the Jesuit order to become involved in putting forth, you know, a discussion about the theological and philosophical challenges that this presents to us. But it's not a national security threat. You know, it's not a threat to our species. It's not a threat to our planet. It's a threat to our view as ourselves as the be-all and end-all, that the entire universe was created as a stage on which to play out the human drama of one single species. You know, that ain't so. But let's get used to it, and let's figure out what the new story is. What is the new story? It is a positive story. What is our role in it? We may not be the star, you know, of it, but we're a good supporting character in the unfolding of our universe. And let's figure out what that story is.
The success of Unacknowledged, which has been seen by hundreds of millions of people now.
Have you not watched Unacknowledged?
What is Unacknowledged?
You got to watch Unacknowledged.
What is that one?
Okay. You gotta watch Unacknowledged.
What is it?
You gotta watch Unacknowledged.
Is that Stephen Greer movie?
Caused the reaction within the intelligence community of the United States. And so what the major media has begun to do is to cooperate with the intelligence community in reporting all this information out, but with this peculiar spin, very subliminal at this stage, that it's a threat.
The project was called the Advanced Aviation Threat Identification Program, run by an official named Luis Elizondo.
I think this is a national security imperative. We have clear things that we do not understand how they work, operating in areas that we can't control.
One of my first cases coming out of law school was for NBC to establish the right of journalists to protect their confidential news sources. I did the amicus briefs for the New York Times and the Washington Post and also for CBS and ABC. And it was at that time that I began to realize that there was this close working relationship between the board of editors of the New York Times and the national security community. That there's conversations going on all the time between the board of editors and the national security people. And we actually got an affidavit from Teddy Sorensen saying that, oh yes, the national security state and CIA and everybody consult regularly with the New York Times to get them not to tell information about covert operations that we're engaged in. I was surprised to find that out at that point. I began to do an investigation about this as the lawyer for the Times, now and for NBC, and found out that there were 42 full-time Central Intelligence Agency, or NSA, people employed by the major national news media. And they had an entire project called Project Mockingbird, and that they were deeply embedded with the major national news media, and they were constantly, from their point of view, safeguarding the information that was going to be allowed to get out. And it was quite clear that they viewed themselves as all part of the same basic fraternity. They all shared in the patriotic vision of the Central Intelligence Agency being able to go around the world. The thing we had the biggest challenge with on the Pentagon Papers case is they didn't want to reveal the fact that there was a massive assassination program going on, and it was being funded by heroin trafficking. You know, to keep it away from the congressional funding investigations, et cetera. I thought this was a terribly newsworthy thing to tell about, but it was beyond the pale. That was not to be talked about here. You know, you can talk about how bad the Vietnam War was and even the fact that they lied about the Bay of Tonkin incident, but not this.
Even the Air Force Office of Special Investigations officer, Richard Doty, admitted that he would bring bags of cash to national security editors in the major media to get their cooperation in this narrative.
So every news agency, every television, radio station in the Albuquerque or Santa Fe area had our snitches in there. So we knew, and we paid them. We paid them good money. One of the reasons you get the people is you pay them. And And that was controversial. That was somewhat controversial.
Do you know of national media that have had
Oh, yes, yes, yeah. I'm not going to name them.
What you have now is a concerted effort between mainstream media, social media platforms, and tech giants to say, let's gain control back of the narratives that we require to make sure that we can control how people think about certain topics. So now you have this fear-driven, you have this tight little box of what the UFO and the extraterrestrial subject is really about, how it relates to military, government spending, weapons, all the sort of conversations that are very common in the mainstream that people are gonna relate to, that they, okay, I can piece the typical dots together.
Let me give you a great example. If you look at a lot of the Disclosure Project materials, which is beyond the scope of this film, we identify dozens of people who are at intercontinental ballistic missile, nuclear silos, nuclear weapons areas, who had UFOs come in to those areas, surveilling them, but in some cases rendering those missiles unlaunchable. Now, most of the men that were in those silos have said to me personally, they felt that these ETs were saying, please don't blow up this beautiful planet, but if you do, if you go to mutual assured destruction, the full launch of nuclear weapons globally, we can intercept a lot of them so that you don't go to a full extinction level event. They felt that it was actually a very hopeful thing that happened. Meanwhile, people came along, took the same data, the same cases, and spun it into a national security threat. One set of facts, two narratives, diametrically opposed, opposite.
When I got involved in the issue of the UFO issue and the ET issue, starting in 1977 with President Carter, I realized that the work that I was doing was characterized by the national security state as a target for counterintelligence activities. When I see this thing happening with this To the Stars Academy, where they suddenly appear on the front page of the New York Times, and the CNN all of a sudden wants to talk with them, and they're on MSNBC and all this kind of stuff, I immediately kind of realized, wait a second, this is part of what I've been worried about coming out, because they were constantly spinning this story that this is a threat.
My name is Tom DeLong. A lot of people know me from my band Blink 182. I started that band when I was 16. Through a series of meetings, I was soon connected to a large group of U.S. government officials from the CIA, the Department of Defense, and Lockheed Martin Skunk Works. These guys were the ones involved in the secretive U.S. government programs that dealt with these subjects.
What's happening is the To the Stars Academy people, we're all, you know, Jim Simivan, who's there, you know, the chief of covert operations domestic for CIA, which in and of itself is totally against the law. You know, the National Security Act of 1947 completely, clearly, and unequivocally prohibits any kind of covert operation stateside, but here that's who he is. And there he is there, and you got guys from the DIA and the Defense Department and Hal Putoff and stuff, and they're all there. And what they're doing is they're putting this intense spin. Every single thing they talk about all has this kind of gestalt to it, that this is a threat.
And it very well could be a threat.
It's a threat to our national security. It's a threat to our airspace. It's a threat to our sovereignty. It's what it is. It's a threat to our dominion over our own planet. And of course, they think that's their job. Our job is to assert full spectrum dominance over the entire planet. We actually have the documents from the 1992 United States Defense Department Policy Planning Guidance document, where they said that right at the end of the dissolution of the Soviet Union, said, oh, we've got to not cut back on our military spending, we have to increase it so we can establish full spectrum dominance over the planet. And so you know what their agenda is, the national security state. It's not for the defense of our sovereignty.
The danger of this, of course, is that this is exactly what all fascistic demagogues do to an innocent target, whether it be Jews in Germany or African Americans in this country. They will create sort of a boogeyman effect to try to get people mobilized against it.
You're one ugly motherfucker.
And as one member of a royal family told me, we need to do things so that the public will accept in blood and treasure the sacrifices needed to have an interplanetary war, I'm quoting.
Bombshell CIA documents, previously published by the Disclosure Project, reveal a decades-long psychological warfare campaign to cultivate a culture of fear towards extraterrestrials.
And it's interesting that Hollywood and the clandestine services are both spend most of their time convincing people that something that's not true is in fact true. I think probably Hollywood is full of CIA agents and we just don't know it. And I wouldn't be surprised at all to discover that, you know, this was extremely common.
Intelligence assets within Hollywood have made billions of dollars popularizing the narrative that humanity's first encounter with ETs will be a devastating bloodbath.
Mr. Chambers, don't get on that ship. The rest of the book, To Serve Man, it's a cookbook.
Let's go out into space and look at our planet over the last 100 years. World wars, hundreds of millions of people killed in war, the advent of weapons of mass destruction, our going into space in a competitive way with the Soviet Union for the Apollo projects and others, the degradation and destruction of our environment, our targeting of extraterrestrial assets around the Earth and in space, and successfully killing many ETs and downing their spacecraft. Out here in Fort Huachuca in Arizona, there's an underground facility where there are 9 different ET craft that are there with all the autopsy bodies. There's a man on my team who used to work in that facility near Tombstone, Arizona, not coincidentally, perhaps.
This footage, captured by NASA's Discovery Space Shuttle on September 15, 1991, shows an extraterrestrial vehicle dodge an electronic weapon fired from Earth. Here, we see the craft slowly crossing the frame. There's a bright flash, and then it makes an abrupt right angle turn and flies off. Moments after the turn, we see the shot fired across space where the craft had just been.
Knowing all that, if they were hostile in the way we think of an invading, hostile force, that would have been made abundantly clear to us the day we detonated the first atomic bomb. The fact is, they have shown remarkable restraint, almost a level of a Gandhian pacifism, not to have pushed back. So the threat isn't extraterrestrial. The threat is covert human. These secret projects are an existential threat to Earth, the environment, and to our peace in space and relationship with these civilizations. I remember being at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, where a lot of the Roswell stuff ended up, and it was the Foreign Technology Division of the Air Force. And I was there to do a briefing, and the colonel said, well, what if these civilizations are a threat? He was trying to bring me into that view. And I said, sir, with all due respect, given the galactically stupid things you have been doing, if they were a threat, you would know it by now, and we would not be having this conversation and breathing the free air of Earth. It would have been point, set, match, over. What are the technologies that would permit an interstellar civilization to go from one star system to another? Now, we're not talking about Elon Musk's SpaceX or the Apollo rocket. We're talking technologically advances that are in the hundreds of thousands to millions of years past what we have operating on this planet. Those technological breakthroughs, if they were weaponized and in the possession of a hostile force, would be so devastating that you could target a planet and turn it into a pink mist floating through the cosmos if you were a hostile entity. What I have discovered in our contact with these civilizations, and we have had many hundreds of contact experiences with our CE5 teams around the world over the last 30 years, is that none of them are hostile, but quite a few of them are very concerned about our hostility and are doing things to try to contain that.
But our destiny beyond the Earth is not only a matter of national identity, but a matter of national security. It is not enough to merely have an American presence in space. We must have American dominance in space.
They want to project out into the stars their dominion.
Our job is to get people to understand that that is not what our mission is as a human species. We need to lay back, participate with all other sentient life in the universe, and merit a proper position in the galactic, you know, federation, not be the big bully on the block.
Counterintelligence efforts reach a new level of absurdity with the staging of host events like cattle mutilations and alien abductions. In 2017, retired Air Force intelligence officer Richard Doty made history when he admitted on camera that unacknowledged special access projects within the military do indeed stage alien abductions to lay the psychological foundation for an interplanetary conflict sometime in the near future.
We did do that, yes. OSI did that. There was a special group out of the 7602nd Air Intel Wing at Fort Belvoir that came out and did that. They had these people that had maybe some sort of defects, anatomical defects that were brought in to fool people and thinking they're aliens. Yeah, I can't give you any specifics because it's still, the program is still classified, and they're probably still doing it. I wouldn't doubt it. They were still doing it.
This corroborates what dozens of other insiders have disclosed to Dr. Greer, but they're too afraid to testify on camera.
Colonel, you're about to find out who your alien really is.
General Saul!
Some years ago, I had a meeting with the Crown Prince of Liechtenstein, Hans Adam von Liechtenstein. He had reached out to me through some of his contacts. He said, look, Dr. Greer, we have to meet, but we can't talk about this on the phone. Your efforts to effect disclosure are noble, but they will not be able to be permitted, and not for the reasons you think. I said, well, this is interesting. Finally, we got together in New York City in July of 1994. He said to me, in 1989, a group of us were trying to do disclosure, and it involved Gorbachev, President Bush Sr., himself, and the UN Secretary General Perez de Cuellar. And in the course of us putting together the high-level planning meetings to do this, Perez de Cuellar, the UN Secretary General, was abducted out of his limousine in Manhattan. He was told by the aliens that if they did not cease and desist from their plans to disclose this information, that every world leader involved, including the President of the United States, would be abducted. This blew up like an atomic bomb in the Bush White House, and it did not go forward. I said, okay, well, tell me more. He says, well, we've concluded that we have to prepare the public for an interplanetary war. And in doing so, we can then also force the return of Christ. I'm quoting. And I just listened. He didn't know that I knew that the means for that abduction for Perez de Cuellar were run by a counterintelligence unit out of the national security state that had the technologies to simulate an alien craft and aliens run completely by military assets, and that there was a deeper part of these unacknowledged special access projects that were zooming even people like Bush Sr., who was on the committee but had lost control of some of these renegade factions. This is a very complicated story. Perez de Cuellar being abducted caused him to stop that process. It manipulated these leaders into going onto a war footing. And he confessed to me that the reason he was funding the work of the abduction groups was because they wanted to put information out to the public that would scare the public so the people would make the sacrifice in blood and treasure to have an interplanetary war. Now, this is 25 years ago. Was not a happy meeting for me.
If there's any one thing that is going to mobilize people to allow the national security state to establish full spectrum dominance over our planet, it is this. The beings themselves, interestingly enough and very importantly, aren't putting out their own story. They're not doing that yet. They're trying to get us to understand it. They're trying to give us warnings. They're trying to help raise our consciousness, which is a critical part of this entire operation going on, and trying to get us to do this for ourselves. That's what this is all about. But the national security state realizes that that's a slower process, so they're now trying to hurry this up. There's a kind of an emergency process underway right now. You know, make no mistake about that.
When I was briefing the director of the Defense Intelligence Agency, the very first thing he asked wasn't about this subject. He looked at me, he says, Dr. Greer, what we don't understand is why you haven't killed yourself yet. He said, well, my dad knew about some of this way back in the 60s. No one would do anything about it. So he took his revolver and ate his gun and blew his head off. Now, this is a three-star general telling me this story in the first 10 minutes we're together. I said, well, I'm sorry that happened to you, but I understand where your dad was coming from. Because it's sort of this, anyway.
Oh, take a break.
Now the truth is, there are a lot of people who've been on my team who are military, who've killed themselves. Others who have been assassinated. So the other thing that keeps me up is, you know, survivor guilt.
Sorry. This national security state is the bane of our human existence right now. And so we have to start disassembling that national security state because, you know, even assuming, say, Bernie Sanders, hypothetically, were to become president, you know, the national security state isn't even going to tell him where the washrooms are. And, you know, that whole group is going to descend upon him, and they're going to give him at least as much trouble as they've given Trump.
If you got into the office and you found out something about aliens, if you found out something about UFOs, would you let us know?
Well, I'll tell you, my wife would demand that I let you know.
So that's why they want Joe Biden and Kamala Harris to come in and kind of, you know, continue to get things, quote, back to normal, where the national security state is functioning. They're all operation, you know, they're all going to brief Goldman Sachs, and they're putting people from Goldman Sachs in charge of the economy, you know, that kind of thing. We have to rise above those kind of dialectical politics. Bring the people up, raise the consciousness of the people, and have this function through democracy. We've got the tools here. They're in front of us, and we've got access to the internet still. They haven't taken that away from us yet, but there's a short window here.
One exception to the almost universal failure of world governments to initiate peaceful diplomacy with ET civilizations took place in France in 2007. Then-President Sarkozy's Ministry of Defense reached out to Dr. Greer to train its senior officials in the Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind protocols. During a covert test run in the French countryside, ET craft were tracked overhead going 200,000 kilometers per hour. And this massive mauve-colored craft partially materialized a few meters from the group. Since the operation was swiftly halted by national security state interests, it remains the duty of we the people to become peaceful ambassadors to the universe. Much like a denial of service cyber attack can bottleneck and bring down a computer network, millions of people initiating contact would completely overwhelm the national security state's ability to subvert disclosure.
The national security state people, and potentially working with and through the To the Stars Academy, are going to be pitching this problem. Say, well, you know, we can't just let our whole civilization know that there is this highly advanced, technologically superior society out there, and because our whole culture will collapse. Whereas, in fact, it's quite clear that it's their defense of the elite, this 1% of the human family that basically ends up controlling over 40% of all of the wealth on the planet, that they're really defending. And it's their world that they're trying to defend. So that you see that this is a subset of a larger question about how spiritual consciousness and the evolution of consciousness, of understanding what we really are in the makeup of the universe, is a threat in itself to this elite. because that is the dissolving away of these kind of differences among ourselves and this coming into a full ownership of our proper place in the universe puts these people out of business as the ruling elite. And so that the raising of consciousness of our human family is so closely related to the opening onto the extraterrestrial experience that both of them together are viewed as a threat by the elite. What they're afraid of is that this is such an accelerator as people have these repeated contacts with the extraterrestrials, their whole consciousness starts to rise. They start becoming aware of the fact that we're damaging our environment. They can become aware of the fact that nuclear weapons are kind of an insane thing to have. War is a really bad idea. This is a spiritual experience. It's a spiritual stimulation that's coming.
If you take someone from Italy and someone from Japan, very different cultures, very different people, personalities, backgrounds, emotional temperament. Now, extrapolate that out across the cosmos. Think of the vast differences we're going to be. How do we make any sense of that if we aren't anchored into something deeper? And that point of commonality has been folded within each of us. And that is we are awake, conscious beings. They are awake, we are awake. That faculty of being aware of awareness, the consciousness, not what you're conscious of, but the means to be awake. That is a singularity. And once we're anchored into that state of consciousness, the unitive state, then there aren't any aliens. There are just other people who are a little different from us. This is the point where we can make contact most easily. I looked at Close Encounters of the Third Kind, I said, well, somebody knows what's going on here. Because it had a lot of to do with the telepathy, the sort of dreams people had that led them to the Devil's Tower in Wyoming, all this. And I then found out that Spielberg had actually had a man, J. Allen Hynek, who was the head of Project Blue Book for the Air Force, who was the chief consultant who opened up files for him so he could make that movie almost like a docudrama.
In 2011, a CE5 group at Joshua Tree National Park successfully contacted an entire flotilla of ET craft. In the unprocessed night vision footage, we see what appears to be two distinct craft. But image enhancements reveal that these are two parts of a superstructure or mothership surrounded by an entire fleet of ET vehicles. How is this possible? It is not possible to simply crowbar extraterrestrials into our traditional, relatively primitive view of reality. In order to make sense of things, and indeed, in order to make contact, we have to pause and readdress our assumptions about the very nature of reality. This is an essential reflection which reveals that the mystery of extraterrestrials is but a signpost that points to a far more profound and intimate secret, one with the power to transform us and the cosmos forever.
One day I went to my mailbox and I got out a little flyer and it said, we're inviting you to a meeting with Ben Rich, the chairman and CEO of Lockheed Skunk Works, former UCLA alumni. He'll be speaking to the engineering alumni group about his time at the Skunk Works. So as he was finishing his talk after about 45 minutes, his last slide was a black disc zipping off in outer space. And he ended the talk by saying, we now have the technology to take ET home. And the whole room burst out laughing. We said, did he just say that? And as he was walking away, I followed him and I said, Ben, he turned around and looked at me. And I said, Ben, I'm really fascinated with what you had to say today. And I said, I would really love to know how we would do that. What we use to get to the stars? He looked at me, trying to figure out who I was, I think. And he said, well, let me ask you a question. How does ESP work? And I was really taken back because frankly, I was asking a question. I wasn't expecting to get a question back. So the first thing that popped in my mind was all points in space and time are connected. So I fired that answer back to him. I don't know, all points in space and time are connected. He said, that's how it works. He turned around and he walked away.
This astonishing admission from a top military industrial complex insider proves to be much more than a simple analogy. The physics of UFOs, how they travel and communicate through interstellar distances, how they generate power, how they're manufactured, is beyond the grasp of unclassified mainstream science. Instead, a model of reality that accounts for ESP is the only model in which we can begin to comprehend ET technology.
If you're traveling beyond the speed of light, I call it the crossing point of light. It's like this beyond the sound barrier. Well, there's something beyond the light barrier. And you're going from, say, the Andromeda galaxy. That's 2.5 million light years away. So at the speed of light, it would take 2.5 million years for them to get here. The speed of light's too slow. You cannot go from point A to B through the cosmos through a linear system of transportation. Moreover, you cannot communicate through those distances with something at the speed of light, which is what your cell phone and all these radio frequency electromagnetic communication devices we use now on Earth are using. Any civilization that is here, that is interstellar, by definition is transdimensional. They're passing through other dimensions and dropping out of linearity and going from A to B, boom. Almost like a teleportation where it's that resonant effect from point A to B. Any communications systems that these ETs have are also going at the speed of not light, but of thought, a quanta of thought. We think of consciousness and thought as this sort of amorphous, irrelevant, interesting, but mystical thing. But the central operating system and communication system for all interstellar civilizations is consciousness and thought and technologies that interface with them.
God, prana, chi, magic, consciousness. Every culture throughout history has had a word to describe this intangible energy that connects everyone and everything. Decades of laboratory studies show that our minds have a mysterious ordering effect on quantum level phenomena. Despite overwhelming scientific evidence, most people would still be shocked to learn that certain scientists have known that the force is real for a very long time.
One of the people that I met in the course of doing this work was astronaut Edgar Mitchell, who was the sixth man to walk on the moon.
We have sightings of all sorts. There seems to have been a great deal of secrecy surrounding the so-called UFO event.
He had an experience in space, an expanded state of consciousness, that led him to form the Institute of Noetic Sciences to study the science of consciousness. I also brought him to the briefing I did in 1997 with the head of intelligence for the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Tom Wilson. The data on that has since leaked out. Edgar Mitchell realized there was this connection between space and these extraterrestrial life forms and the science of consciousness that was very integral to the study. Most of the people that I have met with in senior science, NASA, aerospace, and intelligence community figures know that the key missing ingredient out of most people's understanding of the whole UFO phenomenon is the science of consciousness. The ETs are trying to encourage people to understand higher consciousness and universal mind, to be able to have a relationship with them that's going forward into the future. And Edgar Mitchell realized that quite early on because of his own personal experience out in space as the sixth man to walk on the moon.
What's the nature of the universe we live in? What is our relationship to the larger reality? If that's a part of the larger reality and we're denying it, that to me is unconscionable.
I theorize that there is a spectrum of consciousness available to human beings. At one end is material consciousness. At the other end is what we call field consciousness, where a person is at one with the universe, perceiving the universe. Just by looking at our planet on the way back, I saw or felt a field consciousness state. Dr. Edgar Mitchell.
We've thought for a long time that the closer we could look at the operations of cells in our body and our brains, the closer we'd come to finding the location of consciousness. And while there's been fantastic work at mapping neural connections and understanding more and more about the brain and memory, what we find is that we still don't know where consciousness is.
Adam Michael Curry is an inventor and entrepreneur whose groundbreaking work as a teenager caught the eye of Princeton's Dean of Engineering, Dr. Robert John. Dr. John recruited Adam into the Princeton Engineering Anomalies Research Lab, where they studied the mysterious ordering effect of consciousness on quantum systems, an effect they called mind-matter interaction.
Now, a non-localized picture is the picture of consciousness on which we're converging now, which is to say that consciousness does not seem to be strictly produced by the brain. It involves the brain, but there's something much deeper going on here. Consciousness may not be localized to our bodies, but may be a fundamental feature of the physical world in which we live.
The universe looks less like a big machine than a big thought. Dr. Dean Radin, Chief Scientist, Institute of Noetic Sciences.
Consciousness, this faculty of being sentient, awake, is not limited to our brainwaves or our bodies, but in fact transcends the limits of space-time. It's an unbounded field of awareness. And that is true whether you recognize it or not. Interestingly, doesn't matter if you intellectualize it, that is the reality of it that has been proven through scientific studies, such as Dr. John's work at Princeton, where they would have people put their awareness on a random number generator that's spitting out zeros and ones randomly, and would intend to shift it, say, towards zeros, and it would shift without any linear wires, just their thought.
Essentially, what a random number generator does is it looks at something intrinsically random in the physical world, typically a quantum process, and it converts those into a string of ones and zeros. So you can think of it kind of like a coin flipper where heads is one and tails is zero. Now, if you collect a large enough sample size, you find a 50-50 distribution of these ones and zeros, meaning physical reality is behaving the way it should. Well, if you get somebody in front of a machine and you ask them to use their intention to mean shift the thing to more ones or more zeros, what you find is that there's, not all the time, but often, a significant mean shift in the direction of their intention. Now, that's a very simple experiment, but the implications are absolutely profound. That suggests that, in fact, consciousness does not seem to be just an illusion or just a localized phenomenon, but that it does have some sort of capabilities to affect the probabilities at the deepest layer of reality, down in the basement layer in the quantum world somehow.
In this flow, mind and matter are not separate substances. Rather, they are different aspects of one whole and unbroken movement. Dr. David Bohm, physicist.
The best way to understand non-locality is to understand that in both physics and in consciousness, there is a connection that exists amongst all things, from photons to people to awareness, that isn't limited by space and time per se, that are woven within each other. Dr. Emoto, the Japanese scientist, began to experiment with water and people putting their intent on the water. And he did photography that would show these different crystalline structures. If it was a very negative emotion, the crystals would be all dissonant. But when it was highly ordered conscious or love, the structures were these beautiful ordered structures that he would photograph. And this was repeated by other scientists. Water has a crystalline component, but it's also tied into, like all matter in space and time in the universe, to this consciousness force field. If you enter into just a quiet state of consciousness and intend something very positive, it literally altered the structure of the water itself.
Non-locality is au courant with modern physics. Schrodinger talked about non-locality and entanglement in the 1920s, but it really wasn't until 1970 that Friedman and Clauser at Berkeley discovered that photons born together like identical twins can move off into the distance from one another, and you grab one twin and you change the polarization of the other, even though they're very, very far apart. And the lingo describing this in modern physics is we would say they're entangled with one another.
There was an unpublished experiment that we did at the PEAR lab, which we called plant RNG. You have a room with no windows, and you have a house plant that needs light to grow. You have a single growing light up on the roof. The growing light can turn in one of four quadrants, and which quadrant that light is showing is controlled by a random number generator. So you put the plant in one corner of the room. The light has an equal chance of shining in all four quadrants. But you give it enough time, and what you find is the light actually shines far more often on the plant than on the other coordinates. It's as though life itself, even life or consciousness in something as simple as a houseplant, bends probabilities in the physical world in the direction of what it needs, in the direction of its growth and its evolution. I see that experiment as profound because it shows to me what consciousness does in the world.
How could ESP work? Does ESP violate any physics? First of all, you can't violate the laws of physics, not like going through a stop sign. If you have a phenomenon, physics has to change to agree with your phenomena.
The biggest interest in classified intelligence projects has to do with the science of consciousness, because even during the Cold War and before, in World War II, they realized that there were a people on the other side of some of those conflicts that were very adept at what's now called remote viewing, the ability to use consciousness to spy on a remote place. These programs began to be studied scientifically and then routinized, made routine, in the intelligence community back in the 40s, 50s, 60s.
You could say my spiritual development was paid for by the CIA. It's a very unusual situation.
In 1972, Dr. Russell Targ, a laser physicist at the Lockheed Missile and Space Company, joined the Stanford Research Institute to begin a CIA-funded psychic espionage program using remote viewing to gather intelligence on distant targets.
So we had a 20-year program at Stanford in which we worked with the CIA to describe what the Russians, what the Chinese were doing. And we were forecasting on a Monday whether the market would go up or down the following Friday. And we made 9 forecasts like that, 9 weeks in a row, and they were all correct. We made $120,000 and were on the front page of the Wall Street Journal. So back in 1982, when we were making money on Wall Street, ESP was real.
Everyone who is seriously interested in the pursuit of science becomes convinced that a spirit is manifest in the laws of the universe, a spirit vastly superior to man, and one in the face of which our modest powers must seem humble. Albert Einstein.
We didn't invent remote viewing. It was known since biblical times. The Buddha spoke in very great detail about how to quiet your mind, look into the future, and if you're an accomplished meditator, you were expected to be able to see into the distance, see into the future, heal the sick, and diagnose illnesses. And various times during the next millennia, people would discover that yes, indeed, you can look into the future, you can look into the distance. And our operation from 1972 to 1995, 23 years, our venture into this was a rediscovery, a recapitulation of what people had known and forgotten during the previous millennia.
Religious traditions and the emerging scientific paradigm are converging on this personal experience of universal consciousness. Dr. Greer first glimpsed this reality during a near-death experience when he was only 17 years old.
You know, if you've died and you know there is no death, then you have no fear of it. And until you have no fear of death, you really can't live. I realized that the consciousness whereby I was awake, that drop of my individual awareness could merge with the ocean of unbounded cosmic mind. So that experience taught me that there's nothing to be afraid of, and there's nowhere to go because you're already there. You just have to open to what's already there within you. This liberated me in a way that I can't even imagine. It is true liberation. Now, you don't have to drop dead like I did to have that happen. I think you can experience that through this deeper experience in meditation. And that's why, after I had that near-death experience, I thought, how do I get back to there without being deathly ill? And so I began to learn how to do meditation. Because the whole universe is actually folded within every single conscious being. It's like a quantum hologram. But if you look at it, every single sentient being in the cosmos has folded within the structure of their consciousness, the entirety of the cosmos, everything. Which is why within these deep, quiet meditative states, you can obtain knowledge, see places, know things, communicate. Because in reality, it's always there. You just have to get into a quiet state of consciousness where it opens to you.
Dost thou reckon thyself only a puny form when within thee the universe is folded? Baha'i teachings.
And so I began to be a student of the ancient Vedas. What I learned was that they had a really excellent articulation, explanation of consciousness, the science of consciousness, higher states of consciousness, and their effect. Now, their effect are known as siddhis, S-I-D-D-H-I-S. For example, the ability to levitate, teleport, dematerialize, rematerialize, bilocate, trilocate, go through solid objects. These are all things that develop spontaneously as you enter into deeper and deeper and higher states of consciousness, precognition, telepathy.
And these were not considered exotic phenomena. These were considered abilities that were available to the experienced meditator. It's just part of quieting your mind, part of the practice, and it's all available.
We have to participate in consciously evolving these faculties that we have that can directly experience dimensions of reality that at the present time are out beyond our direct immediate sensorial system. That's what we're engaged in. That's what this is all about. And that's what these beings are. These beings obviously probably come from like a red dwarf star, some of them, where they've been around 10 billion years longer than we have. And so they've evolved these other faculties in addition to being able to see and touch and taste and do the things they do. You know, and so people are saying, what is our relationship to these beings? Why is it that they even look as much as they do like us, or why we look like them? These are all profoundly important questions of our relationship with other sentient life in the universe, and to understand our place in the order of things.
When you accept what this science is showing us, that we are all connected, and you then say, well, hold on a second, if we're not just connected with human beings, but we're also connected with the plant life, with the planet itself, with the entire animal kingdom, and you begin to develop that deeper sense of empathy with all that, who's to say that that interconnectedness doesn't extend to all the other planets, to the cosmos? If we share that with extraterrestrials, what does that world look like?
If consciousness and thought can affect something at a distance, and at a very great distance, even many miles or thousands of miles away, instantaneously, what does that mean for us communicating with a civilization that is centered in the science of consciousness? And that is their chief operating system. It's not electromagnetic, they use it, but it's beyond that. So now add to everything we know about the internet and communications and telecom, and then add a deeper level of trans-dimensional physics that involve electronic devices very clearly picking up intended, coherent thought. That's what you're dealing with. It's like Dr. John's random number generator experiment on a cosmic scale, but at a level of perfection where there's precision with the thought that you project to it, its reception, and then its activity. Interstellar civilizations are using consciousness-assisting technologies and technologies that assist their own consciousness, both, in all their travel and communication systems. The central operating system for any interstellar competent civilization is the science of consciousness and all the physics that go with that.
We can see an early example of consciousness technology in the mind lamp developed by Siluron. This prototype integrates a random number generator into a color-changing light. Think of a color and the lamp turns that color.
that's what I actually was doing. First, I was doing Sunset.
Oh, cool.
This basic interface between mind and machine points to a deep interconnection between all things that science is only beginning to recognize.
It's the means for us as a civilization to be anchored in something more profound than the superficial aspects of being, say, human. Because humanism isn't enough, because we're dealing with non-human life forms. Now we have to transcend even humanism and our common humanity into this idea that there has to be something more universal within us that's also within these extraterrestrial civilizations that bind us together. And luckily there is. It's this field of consciousness that is cosmic and universal. And that's what's inside everyone. It doesn't matter if it's a homeless person on the street or an MIT professor. If they are conscious and awake, the entirety of the cosmos is folded within them like a conscious quantum hologram, because consciousness isn't limited by space and time. People say, where do I have to go? Well, first you have to go within yourself, but you have to understand what yourself is. And there's your individual ego and self, but there's this deeper aspect of ourselves that is simultaneously interwoven. And when we go deep in meditation and connect to that, then we have reached the point that we can be an ambassador to the universe, because we have become universal.
In our time, this search for extraterrestrial life will eventually change our laws, our religions, our philosophies, our arts, our recreations, as well as our sciences. Space, the mirror, waits for life to come look for itself there. Ray Bradbury.
Once this question mark is introduced into your brain, you start searching out answers. It was like the kind of the Dreyfus character in Close Encounters. You want to know what's really behind the screen. And because we're not being told this, and you know, we do have the ability to change life for the better on this planet, but we're being suppressed and we're being stopped from doing it for a variety of reasons, most of which are greed motivated. So we went out to Oracle, and sure enough, I mean, we did these protocols and we got into meditation, which is something I want to learn about more. And, you know, things started to appear.
And it's fading out.
Yeah, it just went away.
It just faded out.
The steps of this are that you sit in quiet consciousness, and you don't have to have a full-on samadhi or whatever, but just in quiet consciousness, connect to that aspect of your mind that is unbounded, and then intend to sense, feel, see, know where the ET craft is. It could be in another galaxy. Connect to those beings, politely invite them to come and visit you. And then you connect to their communication systems and their consciousness, which are integrated, and you show them where you are. So you kind of zoom in. It's almost like a vectoring, a zooming in from wherever they are to where you are. Let's say if you're in North Carolina, you're coming into Earth, you're coming into North America, the East Coast, the mountains, the Blue Ridge, zoom down to a few square meters around where you are, where you clearly show them where you are. And you do this in a coherent thought sequence that is continuous.
Look at it, where is it?
got it.
Oh my gosh.
Oh.
It's very easy to do once you practice it for a while. The key thing is to first take about half an hour to meditate, go into quiet mind, then sense where they are, and then invite them. Well, people say, well, you're calling them. I say, well, no, it's not like that. You're actually making contact and consciousness and thought before they arrive in their craft or transdimensionally around you. And when the ETs approach us most profoundly is when everyone in the team is in a coherent state of consciousness and are clearly doing this with the intent.
This cohesion with the group, this meditation being part of making contact, which I had no idea. Even though I'm looking at your YouTube videos, that component didn't resonate. It was my scientific brain saying, well, I'm gonna go look at UFOs.
What happens in these groups is there's a coherence between a bond between the group. And when there's a love and a connection there, it enhances the part of making contact because we're together, we're one. There's like a fine love there between all of us.
The second or third night, we had the twin ships come, you know, from the Atlantic Ocean, 9:10 at night. Here's all of a sudden this ship comes in and it's like the size of the sun and it's pulsing. And Dr. Greer, you signal it with your laser and then a second one manifests and they're both pulsing. At that point, my hair is standing up. I have the chills. I'm going, this is amazing. I'm like, it's to actually witness something firsthand as opposed to seeing it in television or see photographs, it's mind-blowing. For me, it was so profound, I couldn't sleep that night. I was just amazed, but the amazement was that, not that I saw it, and actually I needed that because I have that mindset, but the feeling you got. I got this incredible feeling, you have these two ships and then I can't explain it. It's just an emotional state. I was so taken by it.
Once you see something, you can't unsee it. It sort of shattered my small view of the world, and I became aware.
Learning the protocols and making this kind of contact has really helped me move up a notch spiritually. I really feel that it's helped me to really see the oneness in all things. When you're sitting under a blanket of stars, you're really part of it. I mean, it's... You feel your little drop in that huge ocean. Sorry, it's emotional. You have to experience it, but I wish for everybody to have that opportunity.
Mind is a wave of the ocean of being. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi.
When I first started out, it was shocking. The first few orbs I saw, the phenomena I saw, changed my entire paradigm. The first sighting was an incredible triangle formation of three golden spheres over my apartment in Newport Beach, California. I ran outside and saw this formation right above my house at close range, and I managed to capture it on film. As I put the lens on it, I saw there were three perfect golden spheres, all holding this incredible formation over my apartment. The longer I filmed, the more maneuvers they demonstrated, and it was clear the objects were under intelligent control. It was Christmas morning, December 2016. I was on my porch having coffee when I saw this incredible double-staged orb flying through the air. I was following this object upward, and it went right up like it was gonna pass out of my line of sight. When I asked the object, please turn back around, I didn't want the experience to end. Amazingly, it stopped, changed direction, then headed back downward. That was truly profound to me, that I could meditate, send my thought into the universe, and then have a visual response in the sky to confirm that we are interacting with each other. That says something about the nature of mind, the nature of the phenomenon itself, and the power of our own consciousness to interact. In October 2018, we had the biggest sighting I've seen yet in Long Beach, California. My girlfriend and I were in the backyard when we saw this huge white object in the sky. And this was different than most of the normal orbs I filmed. This object was elongated and almost looked like a moving portal in the sky. Amazingly, once I got the camera on it, an incredible triangle formation of orbs shot out of this main object, and I captured it on film. You can hear how excited I am in the film to see this again, this triangle formation for the third time.
What the fuck is that thing? Wow.
Holy shit.
Continued to film the object as it traversed across the sky, when suddenly it started ejecting a series of these smaller orbs, 50 smaller objects and counting. Strangely, I could only see the smaller orbs on my infrared camera. They were not visible to the naked eye. It goes to show you how much is flying around in the sky that we can't see.
About 6 months after I had the near-death experience and I began learning meditation, I was sitting up on a mountain up in North Carolina, and right before sunset, I looked over towards the southwest and I saw a beautiful silver disc, seamless, close encounter of the first kind. It looked exactly like the ET craft I'd seen when I was 8 or 9, when I was a child in North Carolina, which actually ignited my interest in all of this. So I said, oh, well, they're back. I didn't think much more about it. So I sat to meditate, and I went into this very deep meditation. By the time I came out of the meditation, it was very pitch dark, and there was the whole Milky Way galaxy was above my head, and a thought was sent into me that was very clear. It wasn't my random thought or hallucination at all. And it said, behold, what a beautiful universe God has made. And with that, I went right into the state of consciousness that I was in the near-death experience, except now I'm awake and standing on the mountain. And at that instant, I became aware that there was sort of a glow, an energy field right below the peak and through the forest. I thought it was a deer standing on its hind legs, and it had these beautiful deer-like eyes. And I went, what is that doing here, you know? And I realized it wasn't a deer, and it actually appeared and then dematerialized, came over and touched me on the right shoulder. But I could sense its energy field was still there. It was phasing in and out of 3D and the near dimension of astral energy. And when it touched my right shoulder, I could actually see my ski jacket indent. And all my hair stood on end. It was like this electromagnetic pulse. And I had long hair, and it was like, ding! At that instant, I vanished off the mountaintop onto the ship. And then we were, bang, almost instantly out in space. So at that point, I stayed in this meditative state and was teaching the ETs what it was like to be in that state of consciousness, but also be a boy, a young man on Earth. They were very interested in this. And then we kind of merged together in our meditation, and I created with them this protocol for making contact with them.
2 years later, Dr. Greer attempted to recreate the experience during a meditation teacher training course in the French Alps, resulting in the first mass witness CE5.
What we experienced in France was really life-changing for me. It was the summer of 1975, and that was the year we both turned 20. When we were in teacher training, it was very intensive. We were meditating, doing yoga, listening to endless tapes of Maharishi.
So I did a deep meditation, went into this state, and could sense where in space these ET crafts were, connected to them, introduced myself by name, and then vectored them like you would vector a jet into JFK Airport.
All of a sudden, right out of nowhere, appeared a metallic, silent, tetrahedron-shaped silver ship. It just appeared, and I said, what is that, Steve? There was no sound, and it was just suspended in the air and then gone, and there was just the blue sky again.
It will happen if you do it with just a pure state of innocence about it. And that's when I realized that this can actually be done with groups of people, and I just filed that away.
Snoopy 2, if you would, turn towards the tower and show me your light so I can look over that way with glasses. That's two, Roger. We got, I don't know where they got to now. There was two of them. They were low, and then it went to about 4,000 foot and started circling. There was two of them. No navigation lights at all on them.
In 1977, Dr. Greer discovered how precisely he could vector ETs to a specific location. Upon reconnecting with those beings using the CE5 protocols, he showed them his location in the Blue Ridge Mountains, but first directed them to where he was born and raised, in Charlotte, North Carolina. Then he went to sleep.
two objects over the Coliseum. Yeah, I do have something. I got a Cessna out there eastbound. I don't know what the other one is.
Negative, you got two of them out here to keep circling.
Unbeknownst to him, that attempt to initiate contact precipitated a major sighting over Charlotte involving pilots and air traffic control. An insider has leaked the FAA traffic control tapes that corroborated the encounter.
Snoopy 2, no sir, I'm not painting a target right now.
Everything, Roger. We got something out here flying around. I don't believe in flying saucers, but it ain't aircraft, but I don't know what it is.
What I experienced was that I'm awakened and there's this kind of beautiful cobalt blue ship, maybe 20 feet above the ground outside my window, the bedroom window. This wakes up my housemate who's in the bedroom adjacent to mine. He comes running out, says, "What did you do?" And the lesson from that was the specificity of the vector. In other words, I was very specific. I vectored them first to Charlotte, showed them where Charlotte was, the epicenter where all this was going on, was over the part of Charlotte where I was born and all that, and then guided them from there up here. And I think what they were saying to me is, we can be very specific with instructions, so, and we'll show you that. It was a teachable moment. And I sort of felt like, I really shouldn't do this unless I have some higher purpose too.
Sounds like a close encounter. That's okay, Roger.
In 1990, he formed the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence to disseminate the CE5 protocols and establish peaceful and sustainable relations with ET life forms. 2 years later, Dr. Greer and his team went up to Woodborough Hill in Wiltshire, England. There, they visualized and thought a geometric pattern symbolizing the trilogy of components that make up the CE5 protocols. Thought, light, and sound. Immediately, this crop circle appeared in the field nearby.
So some of these civilizations that we're interacting with on our teams are in the order of a billion years beyond our development. And all those beings in that civilization are in a state of unity consciousness that is so enlightened that they could be confused with, say, an angel or something, but they're not. They're not from, they're ETs with star systems and planets and bodies, but their level of consciousness would be at the level of, say, the highest spiritual realm. There's a precise correlation to the kind of technology that you will observe and the level of consciousness that civilization has attained. Let's take our own civilization. We're mostly still separate people and we are operating through a reductionist separate paradigm. We're also still very violent and destructive. So let's look at our technologies. Oil, we're burning something and destroying the air. Nuclear power, we're splitting and tearing apart an atom to create heat, to turn a turbine, to create electricity. Coal, we're digging stuff up and destroying mountains and then burning this stuff in a fiery furnace. It's all very destructive. And so our technologies are a corollary to our inner state of consciousness.
In 1964, Soviet astronomer Nikolai Kardashev proposed a hypothetical scale of measuring a civilization's level of technological advancement based on the amount of energy they're able to utilize. A level one civilization, also called a planetary civilization, can use and store all the energy available on its planet.
At that point, their main focus becomes the development of higher states of consciousness. Because they have all the technologies to meet everyone's needs. There's no shortage. Their economic system is non-economic in the sense that there is an infinite abundance for everyone because of these technologies that can materialize things out of the substrate of space-time, the elementals of space-time. So at that point, a civilization becomes really focused on the development of higher states of consciousness. And as they evolve in consciousness, their technologies evolve with them. They will begin to then unfurl the mysteries of consciousness and the cities I mentioned earlier in the Vedas, but those get applied technologically, which include levitation, teleportation, dematerialization, bilocation, where the same object can be instantly, resonantly created and be in two places at once. We've had this happen on our team.
As water by cooling and condensation becomes ice, so thought by condensation assumes physical form. Everything in the universe is thought in material form. Paramahansa Yogananda.
I like this story of this Lockheed Skunk Works top secret witness who defected. He was trying to learn a technique to go into meditation but then astrally project, and he did. And he went up out of his body with his astral body of light, went up into the air and slammed right into the side of an ET spacecraft. Well, what he couldn't understand was that when he bumped up against the ET spacecraft with his astral body, the body all of you, when you have a lucid dream and you're flying over the water or flying over, that is your body of light. Same thing when you have a near-death experience, you go in your body of light. Well, his astral body hit the side of this craft and it rocked it. And then he popped inside and the ETs were looking at him like, my God, why don't you watch where you're going? Cosmic faux pas. But he moved the ship. He says, how did my astral body move that ET spacecraft? I said, because the density of that spacecraft, resonantly, energetically, was identical to your astral body, because with the naked eye, it was shifted out of 3D into this dimension that is increasingly conscious energy and conscious forms. And since like can interface with like, your density of your astral body and that craft, because it was shifted to that level, it could interact with it. Now, had it been a 3D craft that had stepped down, like a transformer, stepped down into full 3D, he would have gone straight through it, because the density would have been different. The resonant field interface would have been different. And when I explained that to him, he said, now I understand so many things that have happened between me and ETs.
The great thing about C5 is it's anything but remote. It is true contact.
Oh my God!
That was great.
During a CE5 expedition at Mount Shasta, Dr. Greer and his team were in contact with an interstellar object and its occupants in the field in front of them. Suddenly, this light ship lifted off from the ground and turned left, phasing in and out of 3D spacetime before vanishing in clear skies. This was visible to the naked eye for everyone present.
You know, Dr. Greer says our first interest is an academic interest, and in my case, that was how I got into this. But very quickly after that, it changes to a heart, mind, and soul connection that is really a very powerful driving force in your life. And it's important to go from the academic interest to the experience level. And that's what happens very quickly. You make this transition to an experience of this new lifestyle, this new understanding of our place in the universe. We wanted to take action because it's important to not only learn about this academically, but then to take action on it.
It was very empowering for me because I felt like they helped to let us know that we are on the right path and then we have the power to make a change.
It changes you completely. It changes your heart. And then your entire life changes. All things from that point forward are possible.
I have a friend in Holland. Her name's Linda. And she has some very amazing footage that she's captured.
At first I came from Isdalen, that's Norway, where you have a lot of activity there. I wanted to go to bed and something said, no, you have to go outside. Putting my camera up, and then I said, okay, if you're there, can you just fly by and stop? So the craft came at very fast speed and stopped, and then, okay, and flew away.
This is amazing. It'll stop, turn left, turn right, move around at all kinds of angles. And she's had multiple events like this happen.
what will be evident in that footage is what she has actually asked for them to do. So I know there's one case where she has told me herself that they have produced a V-shape, and she requested that in consciousness.
So I looked up, and suddenly something appeared in front of me. And then I said, are you there? And then they come out. They divided themselves in six balls, and then three balls, and there were lots of other lights.
We see this quite often, but it's very unusual to get it on video. And this is why it's a fantastic example of the kind of maneuverability that these spacecraft can make.
I really do love it when people get things like that and they can show people that are new to the subject, because it's really inspiring.
I do want to know what the aliens look like.
All right. Well, the one, for example, that healed this man's hearing, who is in our circle, sort of very triangular head, about 5.5 feet tall. The photograph of it is beautiful, but the experience that this man had was more beautiful.
Had a great experience at Oracle and ended up having a healing experience.
We did these protocols and we got into meditation and things started to appear, and we're photographing it and we're seeing it and we're watching it and we're looking around and everyone's mouths are wide open. A lot of times these craft, they pop in and out so fast that to try and capture them on a telephoto lens is next to impossible.
While in deep meditation, they heard a being walking behind them, phasing in and out of 3D spacetime. Marconi adjusted his camera to shoot in the direction that Dr. Greer pointed. All of a sudden, a teardrop-shaped, trans-dimensional object materialized between Ed Mohn and a medical student, which was witnessed by most of the circle.
We reviewed my photos from that particular time, and there on the hillside, standing behind a man named Ed Mohn, was this being that everyone was like, whoa, what is this?
This being has a very triangular face and has been seen on a number of our expeditions, and they are known as master healers.
Ed couldn't, he wore hearing aids in both ears and he couldn't hear, you know, half the things people were saying to him.
Had hearing loss, you know, from high school. I would avoid parties and social settings where lots of people would gather together because it was uncomfortable not to be able to hear. Got to my room and I felt this draw to go back out there. So I got up and walked out and I saw this red light out in the middle of the desert about 300 feet away or so. I connected with it right away. I could feel it. I knew that it was aware of me and that it was indeed the thing that was calling me. So I invited it to come and hang out. At one point, Daniel heard me talking to this red orb, and he couldn't believe it either. He went and got his camera and took a short video clip of this red orb.
He said that for the next 45 minutes, he had a communication with them. And at the end of the conversation, he said, "Do you think you can do something about my hearing?"
Got some sleep, and when I woke up, I went out to breakfast with some of the people in the group. I had hearing aids, and they weren't with me at breakfast. And it was a very emotional event for me to discover that I could hear everything everyone was saying at the table, and not only at my table, but at tables away from me. And I haven't worn my hearing aids since. I had a hard time finding them to bring them here. They do a very good job, but not as good as the ETs did. It's changed my life. You know, it really has. And that's the part that gets me.
I didn't know this happened to him until I saw him the next day on the hammock. And he was just relating the story, and he was crying like a baby. Just to watch the emotion coming out of him was very moving, and he's had perfect hearing since then.
My takeaway from the event and from my experience with the ETs is that they've been in my life a long time, and I just didn't know it. It's such a beautiful world waiting for us.
It's useful for us to think about our own experience over the last couple hundred years. You go back 200 and some years and show Thomas Jefferson a modern smartphone. To anyone of that period, it would look like something that was magic.
Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Arthur C. Clarke.
We're dealing with civilizations where almost every aspect of how they appear in our time space would look like magic to us. And in the CIA, this is actually called WSFM. Sounds like a radio station. It stands for Weird Science and Frickin' Magic. A spacecraft can be completely 3D like you see a solid aircraft. It can be partially in this dimension, but shifted mostly into another dimension. So I liken this to like when you're turning a dial on an old AM radio and you can move it across and you suddenly pick up Chicago and New York at the same time. They're bleeding together, dimensional bleeding. And so often these ET craft will be partially in this dimension, but mostly out. And all that we will detect in this dimension might be an electronic signature, orb, or an object that appears and flashes in and out, a scintillation of light that then vanishes, or an object that comes in where it looks almost like a hologram of an ET being that will be standing amongst us. But it's an electronically teleported version of that conscious being. I love this one. His name is Bijou. It's pronounced Bijou. He's an interstellar being from Andromeda. And he has a very bright looking nose because there was an orb here that teleported him onto the site. With the naked eye, the only thing that was seen was this sphere that came up right beside my shoulder.
What was amazing is there was a light kind of illuminating this being. He was just floating in sort of this energetic space, and it looked like he was waving at me.
He's sort of doing this, floating. He's in the air maybe 5 feet up. When I asked him where he was from, he said it was from Andromeda galaxy.
Sometimes I have to pinch myself and make sure, you know, I do a little self-check to make sure I'm just really seeing something or it's not my imagination, but that was a huge confirmation that, you know, we are really onto something with what we're doing, that we are really making contact. The ETs are participants in the whole story and this whole unfoldment. So it's really amazing that you're communicating with someone from, you know, an entirely different world, and you know, it's mind-boggling, really.
Now this is beautiful. We were on the beach and this appears right on the sand in front of me, and you can see the eyes very faintly. It's barely in this dimension. It's very crystalline. It's pitch black on this beach. This being highly intelligent, an extraterrestrial civilization at the level of the celestial. So it visualized humanity evolving to the point that everyone on Earth were in cosmic consciousness and enlightenment. That's what we're talking about. 500,000 to 1 billion years ahead of us. Get a load of this. We're in a deep meditation I'm leading. We're in cosmic consciousness. This is a Peruvian doctor, medical doctor. I call it the cosmic spermatozoa. It looks, and it comes in and it wraps around her, and she begins to have the kundalini and an enlightenment experience like she's never had. And of course, this happens a lot on these expeditions, but we got it on photograph. Isn't that cool? I love this one. It's just off the edge of the hill, and you see people turning to look. And it was this object that materialized into this dimension and lit up and then dematerialized. What I saw in my remote view was a very large craft filled with ETs from different civilizations that were joining us in the meditation. Because that's what they're interested in. They're interested if you have a pure heart, a clear intent, and you're wanting to join them in universal peace. That's it. They don't care about your degrees. They don't care about... This is what the Prince of Liechtenstein said. You know, I've gone all over the world where these UFOs are seen, and they're seen before I'm there and after, but when I'm there, they're not around. Maybe it's my attitude. I said, bingo.
Every experience that could be, that was described, no matter how unbelievable, in Dr. Greer's books or the manuals, we've experienced them ourselves. And someone snapped a photo with their iPad, beams of energy in with arrowheads on them coming out of members' third eye and the heart center. When we look closer at the photo here, there was a silhouette, and they were standing, before we had broken the circle, they were standing under the hands of people as we had held hands there. So you could see a bald being with a long robe about 4 feet tall. So that was an amazing shot.
What I began to understand is that there's this whole spectrum of phenomena that involves 3D matter, light, sounds that emerge, tonality, electromagnetic interface. For example, we have electronic devices we'll have out, like a radar detector, magnetometers that pick up the magnetic field shift. Those will all start being activated when a craft is approaching. And we're out in the middle of the wilderness where there's no source of this electromagnetic radiation, but they'll start communicating in a specific cadence and a repeatable cadence. And I call this trans-dimensional electronic communication. And they will actually take over the circuitry of these electronic devices we have out in the desert and begin to do a specific communication. Now, you have to decode it, but it's reproducible. And their different civilizations will have a different pattern. So this is an electronic version of them making contact.
On the shores of the Outer Banks in North Carolina, ETs produce these tones via the team's radar detector. An enormous golden object appeared, illuminating the ocean.
Yes.
Another object appeared and made a 180-degree turn, a maneuver that no satellite can make, then dematerialized in clear skies.
What comes up in the context of CE5 is, oh, something's happening. Oh, what is it? How's it going to affect me? Is it and all the drama comes up. The Independence Day images, the drama that's all through YouTube, all of the programming that is out there comes up because we're saturated in it. What I would suggest to people if they are experiencing fear, or if they feel apprehensive about doing it, make sure you do it in a group. Make sure you set up the parameters of unity, of peace. This is a frequency that is far out of the spectrum of fear. So there's an incompatibility there in a scientific perspective. If you think about resonant waves, the energy, the gratitude, love, joy, peace, all of that, this is a frequency that you establish first through whichever practice appeals to you, and then extend your connection from there.
Researchers have discovered that remote viewing and meditation are most effective when the participant enters a state called heart-mind coherence. The human heart contains 40,000 neurons that can sense, feel, learn, and remember. You can bring your mind and heart into this coherent state and have more access to intuitive knowing by consciously focusing on positive emotions during your meditation.
These beings can, they respond to our thought. They respond to our thought, so they will not be invasive. And if you're feeling like you want to continue whatever contact experience that is happening, but there may be a bit of residual fear that you're trying to work through, tell them. say, look, I'd love to carry on doing this, but I feel a bit scared right now. Can you help me with that? No? And they will.
And that's the other evidence. I know they're not hostile. We've been all over the world, thousands of hours with thousands of people, have had all manner of contact at a distance, intimately, beings, ET beings appearing in our rooms, all kinds of things. No one has ever been harmed. No one has ever been harmed at all. This is in an official document on the FBI website, sort of hidden in plain sight. But it really confirms everything that we're explaining, but also the experience we've had. And this isn't from 1947, so this is 72 years old. He goes through and describes that they are peaceful people. They traverse these dimensions, that they have these abilities in consciousness. He even relates to some of the Vedic terms of the kind of capabilities witnessed from these beings.
All matter originates and exists only by virtue of a force which brings the particles of the atom to vibration. I must assume behind this force the existence of a conscious and intelligent mind. This mind is the matrix of all matter. Max Planck, founder of quantum theory.
Even though what I'm doing with CE5 is what I'm most ridiculed for, it was the project that got the most respect and attention from the intelligence community, because they knew it was real. They knew the science of consciousness is real. They knew that these ET civilizations utilize communication technologies that interface with thought and telepathy and consciousness. They all know this. This is an open secret in the intelligence community. We all think that power is derived from your weapon system, your financial clout, the usual materialistic paradigm. The reason that the deeper elements of the intelligence community have this intense interest in it and don't want the public to know is that, first of all, it is extremely efficient spycraft, which they don't want others to have. Secondly, they know that if people understood the power of consciousness and of mass consciousness, they would be able to completely change the direction of the planet. That is, to me, the big secret.
Most people have heard of the random number generator studies through the Global Consciousness Project.
A question tonight, can you actually measure the emotional outpouring in a worldwide crisis?
Sometimes scientists think that they have done just that. Their machines and computers found a bizarre pattern right after several global disasters.
This was an experiment in which researchers placed dozens of random number generators around the world and analyzed their data to see if they could discover anything about global or collective consciousness.
On September 11th, a few hours before the first plane struck, this network of random number generators became more coherent. Less random and more coherent.
It may sound bizarre, but Dr. Nelson and his team have been at this for the better part of a decade. The first spike showed up in 1997 with the death of Princess Diana. Other events like the Concorde crash, the Madrid train bombing, and the Pope's funeral all registered on those random number generators. But early on the morning of September 11th, the data went off the charts.
The odds of this being a coincidence is less than 1 in 100 billion. This shows there is a deep relationship between collective consciousness and the physical world.
Sociology studies of meditators, where they go into a community, say you have a town of 200,000 people, and they would send in 1% of the population equivalent, 2,000 people, to go into deep meditation. And they found that emergency room visits declined, violent crimes declined, robberies, all kinds of negative behaviors declined, even though those people didn't even know they were in the city. Because there is this resonant effect through the force, if you want to look at it that way, through this entangled, interwoven consciousness field. And people who didn't even know these meditators were there became more ordered, more peaceful, more happy, et cetera, and so on.
This was actually based on the studies done in quantum physics in which a container of helium was cooled down to absolute zero. When only 1% of the helium became aligned to coherent, the entire container went through a phase transition, instantly shifting into coherence and taking on almost magical properties, a state called superfluidity.
So there was this transformation at that 1% point. When a critical mass of people, and whether it's 1% or a fraction of that, depends on the state of consciousness of those who are practicing the meditation or a prayer or coherence. But at that point, you can shift an entire civilization. If we all become coherent, just 1% of us, like a molecule of helium, and we become aligned and coherent and move in the right direction, it will transform the other 99%, even though they don't know that we're doing it. And that's the beauty and the power of the structure of non-locality and consciousness, is that it's all interwoven, but there's enormous power when you're operating at that deeper level of consciousness. And that the intelligence community is very much afraid of, because that's something, A, they cannot control, and B, it would transcend their ability to alter the outcome.
The total number of minds in the universe is one. In fact, consciousness is a singularity phasing within all beings. Dr. Erwin Schrödinger, Nobel Prize-winning physicist.
I'll tell a really funny story. In 92, the head of Army Intelligence and a few of his minions intercepted me and took me to a hotel room, very threatening. There was a National Security Agency person there, CIA people. They were saying, "What the hell do you think you're doing? Teaching people to bypass our systems and contact these civilizations." I said, "I don't recognize your authority over this matter." And then I looked them in the eyes and I said, "I'm not afraid of you, because I died when I was 17 and I know there is no death. I don't care about your money, and I've had direct contact with these civilizations, so you can't deceive me about who they are and why they're here." And the general just sat back like this and went, "We know exactly who this son of a bitch is." And I said, "Yes, so this is what we're gonna do." It was very frustrating for them, but later, a member of one of the European royal families, who I don't want to name, who was involved with that crowd, came up to me and she said, "You know, they're very jealous of what you and your team are doing." I said, "Jealous of what? These are the most powerful people." And he says, "No, they know that you guys actually collectively have all the power, and they wish they could do what you're doing, but they're in the box of this national security state program that they cannot escape from, and you're free. You're a free agent. You're free to do wonderful things, and they're not, and they're really jealous of what you guys are doing." It was a real insight into the sad psychology of the people who are in this pinched, small world. So I say to the public, you should be happy that you're not part of all of that. You have the freedom to do things they can never do. So let's do it.
It's good to know that we have the tools we need when we apply C5 protocols. So anybody can do it, no matter where you're from, you know, what background. You can just learn the protocols. We have a lot of friends from around the world who never been on one of these expeditions, and they just go online and use the protocols and apply them and have wonderful experiences.
I'm practicing CE5 in Cambridgeshire, United Kingdom.
Colorado Springs.
Preston, British Columbia, Canada.
Geraldton, Western Australia.
Bunnerville, North Carolina.
Lexington, Michigan.
Moorhead, Kentucky.
Vancouver Island.
And Shelton, Washington.
New Zealand.
The CE5 will assist in us. Amazing to most of us.
Melbourne, Australia.
Riverdale, Georgia.
Beautiful Buckingham, Virginia.
It's in Germany.
Ontario, Canada.
Scappoose, Oregon.
Vancouver,
Guadalajara, Sydney, Australia,
Winchester, Virginia,
in Darlington, England,
Orlando, Florida,
Knoxville, Tennessee,
in Freistadt, in Austria,
Dubai, United Arab Emirates,
Alexandria, Virginia,
Beit Shemesh, Israel,
Albuquerque, New Mexico,
Japan, Hiroshima, C5 yattemas,
Indianapolis, Indiana,
England,
Sydney, Tasmania.
We are doing a CE5 in Hong Kong and making history.
People from all walks of life are becoming interstellar ambassadors and experiencing transcendent states of consciousness in union with these beings. Thousands are making contact by simply using the guided meditation and the CE5 contact app. It's up to the children of Earth to become active participants in the unfolding of our universe and not leave it to the power elite. Once we reach a critical mass of people, a coherent and enlightened minority can transform the rest of humanity instantly.
It's more about what your intent is. Do you have a pure heart, for lack of a better word? you have a clearness in your mind and in your heart. Can you bring your mind and heart into resonance together and invite these civilizations to connect with you in this great purpose, this great journey that we're launching on as a civilization where we are going to become interstellar? Interestingly, there was a colonel named Philip Corso, and Colonel Corso wrote a book the day after Roswell, and one of the events that wasn't known was this encounter he had with an ET at White Sands Missile Range, and right not far from where the first atomic bomb was dropped. And this was 1956, and an interstellar vehicle came in and it landed. So he gets in his Jeep, rushes out there, it's his young brash colonel, and has a meeting, an encounter with this ET. At a certain point, the ET asked the colonel to switch off these radar systems that had piggybacked on them, electronic warfare systems that were knocking these spacecraft down. And the colonel leaned in and said, "What's in it for me?" And the ET looked at him and said, "A new world, if you can take it."